of herbal antidotes. I'm extremely delighted to have Dr. R.S. Badere sir, who is working as an associate professor in the Department of Botany, Rashtrasanta Tukdoji Maharaj, Nagpur University, Nagpur. Welcome, sir. I now request Dr. Simit Rokde, Assistant Professor and Head Department of Botany, late Pundlikrao Gavali College, Shirpur, Jain, to introduce our chief guest lecturer, Dr. G. Fani Kumar, for the particular session. Dr. Simit Rokde, are you there? Sir, please unmute yourself.
Yes. Now I am audible, sir?
Yes, yes, you are.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, one and all. I, Dr. Simit Rokde, Assistant Professor and Head Department of Botany, Lit Pundlikrao Gavali Arts and Science Mahavidyalaya Shirpur Jain, I'm profusely overjoyed to take an opportunity to welcome our chairman of today's morning technical session, Dr. R.S. Badere sir, Associate Professor, Department of Botany, Rashtrasanta Tukdoji Maharaj University, Nagpur. I welcome you, sir, on behalf of me and organizer of this international e-conference on innovative research trends in life science. I welcome you, sir. It is a great honor for me to introduce and welcome our resource person for this morning technical session, Dr. G. Fani Kumar, sir. Dr. G. Fani Kumar completed his MSc in year 2002 in the year 2000 and his PhD in 2004 from RTM Nagpur University, Nagpur, under the able guidance of Dr. Mrs. Alka Chaturvedi ma'am. He has completed his postdoctoral research from CSIR Neri, Nagpur during 2004 to 2006. He also served at Defense R&D Organization, DRDO, during 2006 at Defense Institute of High Altitude Research, DIHAR, at Leh. He worked in the field of cold desert biodiversity, carbon sequestration strategies of Ladakh, medicinal plants of Ladakh, and electronic flora of Ladakh. He also guided students for their doctoral studies, and under his guidance, three PhD students awarded, five MD Ayurveda students finishes their degree. Then he has transferred to Defense Food Research Laboratory, DFRL, Mysore, in 2010. Since then, he is working in the field of nutritional biochemistry and toxicology of medicinal plants under BioThreat Migration Program. He has attempted to find antidotes against algal toxins. He has developed several food products for anti-stress, anti-fatigue, and anti-motion sickness properties. Even the processes, or we can say methodologies to product development, have been filed under four Indian patents. He has published his research work in more than 50 national and international reputed journals, and his research work is quoted in more than 1400 citations as per the Google Scholar, with H index is 21 and ITN index is 26. Today we are privileged to have an opportunity to listen to him on behalf of organization and all gather here virtually. I welcome you, sir, once again. I welcome you both, today's chairman, Dr. S.R. Badere, sir, and Dr. G. Fani Kumar, sir. Welcome you, sir. Now I hand over to anchor, today's session anchor. Thank you, sir.
Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Good morning. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
My screen is visible for you?
Yes, sir. Yes.
My screen is visible now. May I go ahead?
Yes, sir. Definitely.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, one and all. The course conveners and organizing committee members, organizing secretary, one and all. Very good morning to all of you. And I am thankful to you all to giving me this opportunity also. Now I am myself, Dr. Fani Kumar, working in DFRL, which is the Defense Food Research Laboratory. Just 2 minutes, I will explain about our institute first, then I will come to our topic. So our institute is defense, mainly working for the defense personnel, which means Army, Air Force, and Navy. And our main aim is to provide food products to the armed forces. Along with that, if any contaminations comes in the food, to identify the contaminations, and you provide some detections, developments, and evaluations of those antidotes and contaminants like that. So now I'll come to my present topic, that is algal shellfish poisoning. Actually, the algal shellfishes, which means some of the shellfishes which have been infected by the poisonous algae. Due to this poisonous algae, what happens normally, this algae will get poisoned, and those who consumes this shellfishes, they will get some problems. And now we are working on that, how to develop and evaluate herbal antidotes for those algal poisonings. Now I'll come to my topic one. Now, what are the terrestrial, actually aquatic and terrestrial algal system? What is algae? As a botanist and all the microbiologists, they know very well, this algae is belong to either prokaryotic as well as eukaryotic. Both forms algae is available. For example, cyanobacteria comes under prokaryotic algae, and some other red algae and other things comes under eukaryotic algae. And this is in different forms, like unicellular, filamentous, as well as multicellular. If you go, the number of algae present in this universe is more than some 30,000 available groups are available here. And if you see, this algae is available as well as in fresh water, aquatic, marine water, as well as terrestrial also. And if you see these algae, many what we know about the beneficial algae, we only studies normally, mainly we focus on beneficial algae. And along with the beneficial algae, we have also have toxic algae. Now we'll go through that beneficial, what are the benefits we will get from the algae. Normally, all the fishes in ponds or whatever lakes, the fishes will get food from the algae because they are consuming this algae. And these by one, like a chain, some of the invertebrates and fishes, which is depending on the algae, and humans also will consume these fishes. So that cycle, algae will be useful as a food, as well as animal feed. And some of the algae like nostoc and anabina, which is useful as a nitrogen fixing in, as a fertilizer for nitrogen fixation in agriculture. And then some of the marine algae, which is also called as diatoms, which produces diatomaceous earth, which will be useful for several things. And some of the marine algae will provide you chalk deposits, and some of the algae will provide you agar, which is useful in microbial agar media, and carrageenan. Carrageenan also useful in preparation of your jams and jellies, and other brown algae, which is provided so many phytocolloids, and some of the pharmaceutical drugs, which also useful, which was, can be taken from the algae. And some of the main algae are useful in the modern research for the molecular biology. And some of the believe proteins which is useful in fluorescence microscopy could be extracted from these algae. Now we'll talk about the poisonous algae or toxic algae. How algae will become toxic? We have talking about the so many beneficials, but at the same time we have several problems with the some of the organisms, some of the organisms of the algae. What normally happens when the algae grows in a huge patches, that calls as at a time several algae grows, that is called as bloom. It's a freshwater or marine one. If freshwater, that is called as freshwater algal bloom. If it is a marine, then called as a marine algal bloom. And some of the red algae, which makes a complete patch in the saline area, that means in some of the samunda, that means when seashore is completely made up of this red algae, that area is looking like a red color, like a red tide. That's why we call it as a red tides. And what happens is toxins accumulated in this food chain, which damages several things like paintings of your caves, and some of the works in the caves also will get damaged. And some foul smell will come, which is attached to your ships or sometimes submarines or some other things, falling smell, and your shells, which is present in marine, also get affected falling smell. Due to this, your commercially important bivalves all will get affected by this of toxic algae. And now, algal blooms, harmful algal blooms, also in a short term called as HEABs. These harmful algal blooms are normally made up of phytoplanktons. There are several, either it's a cyanobacteria, that means your cyanogenic algae, that means your nostoc, caramina, whatever, or marine algae, which comes in a single time, so many comes in a single time, and therefore the whole environment will get affected at a time in a patch. And because of the too much algae present in that patch, lower organisms, whatever present inside the water, will not get that sunlight. Therefore, the photosynthesis or other things will not happen. And at a time, so many of algal organisms are growing there, their oxygen depletion may happen. Therefore, carbon dioxide increases inside the water. Therefore, that affects several organisms which may die also. So this HAB, that means harmful algal blooms, can occur marine as well as estuarine and fresh water. Now, all the three places it happens. If you talk about the algal toxins, normally we consider algal toxins freshwater algal. First, we will talk about the freshwater algal toxins. When you talk about the freshwater algal toxins, we normally differentiate into their effects. Some of the effects on liver, which is considered hepatotoxins. Some of the algal toxins are effect on their neuronal system. We call it as a neurotoxins. If you consider this hepatotoxin, normally microcystin is a toxin which is produced by microcystis. Also, Cylindrospermospis roxiburski and nodularins, which is produced by anabina and nodularia. When you talk about the neurotoxins, enotoxin, again produced by anabina, preminicin and saxitaxin. Saxitaxin is a toxin produced by cyanobacteria as well as red algae. When you talk about the cyanobacteria, aphnagomenon, floss equi, this group of the algae, cyanobacteria, will produce a saxitoxin, which is a neurotoxin. And some of the peptides present in anabina will produce this bioactive peptides are considered as a toxins. So these are the normally freshwater toxins. When we talk about each individual toxin, like a microcystin, this is the protein what you are seeing is the microcystin, which is produced by microcystis arginosa, which is normally a polypeptide chain. It's a structural variant. There are so many, 770 structural variants are there. And the toxicity differs from the each variant. And maximum of our areas where ponds or lakes, wherever you see, these microcystin is normally available everywhere. Many of the ponds are having this microcystin. Even when you consider in Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, and the central India also, this is a common or toxin available in India. And this mycocystin 60 to 70 nanogram per ml is sufficient to kill a fish. That means how much it's toxic effect. That mainly damages the liver. Liver, it inhibits the phosphatase enzyme. Due to the inhibition of the phosphate enzyme, it makes a hepatitis. Then this is, that's why it's called as hepatotoxic, because it affects on liver. So it is has to be identified as the LCMS, LPLC, or by MSMS, or other systems are there to provide. When you talk about the Cylindrospermosins, this is also a cyanobacteria, which is produced by Cylindrospermopsis. Actually, this is the tumor producing, tumor inhibitor. It is a cyanobacteria. And the symptoms of this Cylindrospermopsin toxicity normally goes to the cattle, which feeds on this aquatic area, wherever this algae is available. In that area, if any cattle feeds on this algae, then that affects to the cattle, mainly anorexia and some of the membranes, mucus, diarrhea, dysentery, and some other relevant things will happen. And this is also having three variables, like as I've shown here, three different forms. When you come to the red tides, already we have spoken about the red tide. When red algae, which produces toxins, some of the toxins, at a time comes in an area, look like a tide is in color of red. That's why the tides are called as a red tide, which means a microscopic algae blooms present in a single place in a maximum content. Due to this, the whole color of the tide comes into red. Therefore, this is called as a red tide. If you see, since 30 years, the number of algal toxins have increased, and the space also increased, species also increased, and mainly several fisheries are affected, being affected by these red tides. In India, we have seen only in Arabian Sea. But when you go to the Canada and other places, they mainly dependent on the sea feeds. They take fishes, mainly they consume, and they consume on some of the algae present in the marine. So they are normally getting affected. Just a minute. Hello. Madam, please, I'm meeting. Sorry for the disturbance. Then higher economic cost effects, because these are the several animals, fishes, and other things are getting affected by these red tides, because they are feeding these animals, and these organisms, I mean these microalgae, are producing some of the toxins. And we'll know about the what are the toxins these microalgae produces, and how these are affecting on the marine food web. How it really affects the human. Actually, several algae, these some of the small fishes or bivalve mussels or some invertebrates, which is present in the marine system, which is feeding the these microalgae. Once they feed microalgae, some of the this toxin enter into their digestive system or their internal system. When some of the birds and other things, which is again feeding on these small invertebrates or small feeding bivalve mussels or mollusca, then that enter into those birds and other things, zooplanktons and other fishes. When human consumes those fishes, again that comes to the human, and finally it affects into the food chain of the human also. So in this way, this is a long and bigger food chain which is affected by these marine toxins. When you talk about the different classifications of these marine shellfish poisons, why we call it as a shellfish poisonings? Because normally shellfishes present in marine system is depending on these algae, because they are consuming, they are feeding on these microalgae. When these shellfishes are present in marine, these algae goes to their valves, and the toxins is deposited into their bivalves. The bivalves will not be affected to the molluscas, but when any fish or any human consume these bivalve molluscas, that enter into our digestive system, and finally we get affected. When you talk about the shellfishes, how many different types of toxins are available, poisonings, and how these toxins what are the source of organisms. When you talk about the first one, we call it as a NSP, also called as neurotoxic shellfish poison. Because neurotoxic, because it affects on your brain, short-term memories and other things. This toxin is a Bravais toxin. A Bravais toxin produced by the organism Karenia brevis. When you talk about the DSP, which is a diarrheal shellfish poison, normally which produces diarrhea and dysentery, the toxin is chemical structure is vapodoic acid. And the producing organism is Deinophysis. This is also red algae. Amnesic shellfish poison, this is called as ASP, amnesic shellfish poison. Now we are mainly focusing on amnesic shellfish poison in this class. In this lead talk, I am going to be explain about the amnesic shellfish poison, how it is being a toxin. We have studied in our laboratory how much this domoic acid produces toxin in animals, as well as how to control these toxins through our herbal medicines or herbal extracts or herbal other phytocompounds. So this amnesic shellfish poison is called as ASP. And this is amnesia, actually it produces amnesia, short-term memory loss. That's why this is called as the amnesic shellfish poison. The main causative chemical compound is toxin, domoic acid, that is produced by Nidgia and Pseudonidgia, a group of algae, red algae, which produces this domoic acid. The domoic acid is finally giving you this poisoning problems. And for other PSP, this is the PSP means paralytic shellfish poison. This is the causative chemical compound is a Sagzi toxin. When an Alexandrium species, which produces this Sagzi toxin, when a person consumes these bivalves, where this Sagzi toxin is more, that enters into the body and it paralyzes the person. Therefore, that is called as paralytic shellfish poison. That means whomever consumes this, that person, these fishes or those who are consumed this Sagzi toxin, the fishes, finally the secondary or primary person consumes this toxin, they will get affected. And there are several cases, breakthroughs are there in Canada, in some of the Arabic Sea, in Goa, and some other Pacific Ocean, this Sagzi toxin cases are more. And the last one is Ciguatera fish poisoning. This causative chemical compound is a cigotoxin produced by Gambia disco. So these are the photographs we have shown here, how these microalgae look like. When you talk about their main toxins and their organism source and effects, like Sagzi toxin produces by Alexandrium, it is a molecular weight of 250 to 500 daltons. And I have shown here how this Sagzi toxin looks like. And like domoic acid, mainly produced by Pseudonidgia and Nidgia, is a gastrointestinal symptoms, neurological symptoms, short-term memory loss. And which is an amino acid. Domoic acid is an amino acid. Simply is an amino acid produced by these red algae. And vapodoic acid is a polyether and produced by Deinophysis and Procentrum. This is also gastrointestinal symptoms because of this is the, that's why it is called as diarrheal shellfish poison, DSP. And Bravais toxin is again a polyether produced by Karenia brevis. It also produces gastrointestinal problems and also as well respiratory disorders. When you talk about the vapodoic acid shellfish poison, this is the causative organism Deinopsis, and this looks like Deinophysis and Procentrum. These are the two microalgae which produce this vapodoic acid, and its symptoms are rapid onset of gastrointestinal upset, as well as it produces tumors also, intestinal tumors it will produce. And second, if you come to the paralytic shellfish poison produced by Sagzi toxin, and this produced by Alexandrium species, as well as Saxidomus gigantus. The causative organisms are observed, and these are the 20 different variants of this toxin, Saxidoxins are there. Symptoms namely tingling, numbness, loss of motor control, therefore finally leads to paralysis and death. And it's globally available. In Canada, there are so many cases are present every year. Several cases are from the PSP, this is paralytic shellfish poison cases are available in Canada. But India, only one or two cases we have found about this PSP. And then the another one is the now domoic acid, this is the amnesic shellfish poison. Cause two organism is Pseudonychia and Nichia. This is the concentrated this toxin in shellfishes and finfishes. I have shown here how shellfishes looks. Actually, shellfishes are the major food for the coastal areas. And this is a very, they say that this is the costliest food. If you go to the coastal areas, this cost is very high in cost. And people say that this is very tasty, and therefore people will consume it. When these bivalves are full of this toxin, a person consumes this inside material along with that toxin, then the symptoms will come. The symptoms include gastrointestinal abnormalities, dizziness, disorientation, and seizures, and short-term memory loss. And this is also distributed globally. And in India, Arabian Sea, we have seen domoic acid cases. And in Pacific Ocean, several cases have been observed. Canada and other countries, these cases are mainly available. And now we go to what is the this when you talk about what is amnesic shellfish poison, what is domoic acid? Actually, this amnesic shellfish poison is an illness caused by this ingestion of this contaminated shellfish. The shellfish is contaminated by this domoic acid, either mussels, clams, oysters, even several other crabs, which is prey on the shellfishes and finally enter into the food chain, and that makes us into the problem. When what is domoic acid? Domoic acid is an excitatory neurotransmitter. It is a derivative of glutamic acid. Glutamic acid is an essential amino acid present in our brain. And this domoic acid is look like glutamic acid, and it blocks the glutamic acid neurotransmission, and it affects binds to the glutamate receptors, NMDA receptors and kinase receptors. These are the three receptors of the glutamate, NMDA, kinase, in AMPA receptors, which triggers the calcium channels to open. Once calcium channels are open, then what happens that calcium influx will be more. When excessive calcium influx happens, then that stimulates the neurons, and that is called as excitotoxicity. And this condition that enters into the cell gets damaged and cell gets dies. That is called as apoptotic cell death. So this is the way how this domoic acid affects in our memory cells and other ways. And what are the symptoms when a person consumes the affected or toxic the shellfishes, which is full of this domoic acid? When a person consumes, what happens within 24 hours, the one type of gastrointestinal disturbance will happen, which includes vomiting, diarrhea, nausea, abdominal cramps. When you have not noticed this, even within 24 hours, you have not got any treatment, then after 48 hours, it happens headaches, dizziness, confusion, and permanent loss of short-term memory, motor weakness, cardiac arrhythmias, coma, and finally may lead to death if the concentration of toxin is more. If it is less, then within 24 hours, it can come back and you will be all right. If the toxin you are consumed, more consumed, then that affects you every situation, very dangerous situation. Sometimes it may lead to death. In Canada, last year found that 8 members have died because of the shellfish poisoned food they consume. And now we'll come to our way of working, what we have done about this finding of the toxicity of this domoic acid. We have studied this toxicity of domoic acid. We have studied in vitro cell line study as well as in vitro animal experiments. First, we have studied on cell lines, that is caco2 cell line, which is an intestinal cell line. Caco2 is an intestinal cell line. We have studied caco2 cell line morphological observations. We have studied people, we have given domoic acid in different concentrations, and we see the cytotoxicity study and how it has been given the stress to the cell line and how it has made apoptotic cell death. And afterwards, once we have studied this cell line studies, then we went to animal experiments. And we have seen that what are the behavioral changes happened. We are talking about the short-term memory loss, or we are talking about the amnesia, and how really is it affecting that amnesia and other things, and what concentration it is affecting, and what is the chemical result really, whether blood or other organisms are having this domic acid present in that animal, what is the changes in histopathology, or what are the changes in oxidative and neuronal stress. So these things we have studied, and I will go through one by one slides. When you talk about that CACO2 cell line, I have shown here the SEM analysis, scanning electron microscope analysis. This is a control cell line, you can see in the top, where the cells are normal. When we have given the domic acid 75 nanogram, which we have found that LD50, because now we have studied that MTTSA and LDHSA, on that basis we have find that what is the concentration which produces 50% of cell goes to die. Cell death happened, 50% of the cells, that is called as lethal dose. So that's why we consider it as a LD50. Whenever we study the toxic studies, we have to first find out the LD50. What is the lethal dose required to kill minimum of 50% of cells? So that's why we have considered that LD50 is 75 nanograms, and then we have seen that has been affected a huge. And we can see that DAPI staining, we have done DNA damage. The first one is controlled in a blue strain. We can see that 80 nanogram and 100 nanogram, the cells have shrunken. We have given the marks where the cells have been shrunken. If you see the control, cells are in a bulged manner. When we come to the 80 nanogram and 100 nanogram, the cells have been shrunken. That's why we can consider this is a cell death appeared. And we studied that cell death, LDH and cell viability. You can see from control how it has been increased LDH. And the same way, we can see that cell viability, the control is 100%. When we have come to 60 to 80 nanogram per ml domic acid, that has come back to the less than 50% cell viability. And we talk about the how these domic acid produced oxidative stress. If you see the oxidative stress, we considered normally it is in a two forms. One is ROS, called as reactive oxygen species, and second one is RNS, which is a reactive nitrogen species. Because when ROS means not only single, ROS is a group of free radicals, either it may be oxidative free radicals, peroxide free radicals, or H2O2 radicals, or if we consider the RNS, reactive nitrogen species, these oxygen free radicals react with the nitrogen species and produce N more radicals, nitric oxide, nitric peroxide, some other elements. Therefore, what we considered, we make it as a total ROS, how much it is being depleted, increased by this domic acid concentrated application, maybe supplementation of domic acid, how much ROS has been increased. When you see here, fold increase we have seen, control is considered as a single, then there 100 nanogram, almost four-fold increase of ROS is there. When you talk about RNS, if control is one-fold, then when you come to the 100 nanogram of domic acid, when we are given to the cell line, that almost produces 2.75-fold of increase of reactive nitrogen species. That means more number of nitrogen species and more number of reactive oxygen species, that much oxidative stress appears. If oxidative stress more, that means that much cell damage definitely will happen. When you come to the animal studies, what we have done? We have done animal studies. We have observed that behavioral observations. So how we have to see the behavioral observations? We have made some scorecard. That means once we have injected this in three different doses, 3 mg per kg body weight, 4 mg per kg body weight, and 5 mg per kg body weight, we have injected to the animal. We have used albino mice. When we have injected to the female mice, normally toxicity studies will be done in female mice only, not on male mice. Female mice we have done. So what happens? Initially, what we have given a score, when it is a normal, no noticeable behavioral changes, we have given zero number score. When hypoactivity, immobility, that the animal is not much mobile after up to 20 to 40 seconds without rigidity after injection the domic acid, then that considered as a one scorecard hypoactivity. When sedation, it is going on immobility for more than 40 seconds to 60 seconds, then we consider it as a sedation, we have given 2 numbers. When rigidity, we are given 3 numbers. Loss of postural balance, given 5. Tremors or conversion happens to the animal, then we have given as a 6 number. And if the finally that animal dies, then we are given 7 score. So when you have seen the difference in different time periods, in first hour after giving the injection, immediately after first hour, that behavioral changes are more when compared to the slow. That means normally any body, they have its own fighting mechanism, defense mechanism. So initially the defense mechanism may not be working. So therefore the toxicity score was more in initial first hour. When come to the first day, that means after 24 hours, that toxicity comes down. And after that 72 hours, again still coming down. After 72 hours, either the animal will permanently recover, or it may die, or it may permanently will be the same. So that's why we have considered up to 3 days. That means 72 hours we have observed the animal from first hour to 72 hours. When we have given that 3 mg per kg body weight, the score is lesser compared to the 4 mg per kg body weight as well as 5 mg per kg body. And we have seen that animal blood we have taken, and we have seen how much this particular domic acid is present in the domic acid, in the serum. This first, if you see, this is HPLC chromatogram. The first one is a control, pure domic acid. You can see that domic acid. And control mice, nothing is there because we have not injected control mice any domic acid. Therefore, the serum doesn't have any domic acid. When you see that 3 mg per kg body weight we are given, that shows very less. That means it's having 9.75 microgram per ml. And when you come to 4 mg, when we are given 4 mg kg body weight dose injected to the mice, it is a little bit increased in their serum, 10.28 microgram. When it is a 5 mg we have injected to the animal, that is still more, 10.3. That means after the 5 mg, the animal is not surviving. That's why we have not done. 7 mg and more, the animal dies immediately after injecting. That's why we have not used it for the toxicology studies, because once the animal dies, no use of doing study. And after 24 hours of the animals, what we have studied, after 24 hours, the serum clearance is there. The domic acid is not present in the serum. That is cleared by shelf defense mechanism. Up to 24 hours only, this domic acid is present in the serum. That means animal is not able to clean that domic acid. It is taking 24 hours to clean the domic acid from the serum through its excretory mechanism. When you talk about the serum parameters, we have studied the serum parameters in different time periods and different mg of injection, like WBC, RBC, HB, your hemoglobin, other things, and there would be not much differences. We can say significantly there would be no difference in serum parameters. What we have observed, plus or minus is coming, there would be no much difference. That means significantly it is not affecting on serum parameters up to 5 mg and up to 72 hours. And the same way, we have seen liver parameters as well as kidney parameters and other protein, other things like AST, ALT, ALP, creatinine, blood urea nitrogen, albumin, protein, triglycerides. These there also, there would be no much significant differences observed. Only it is affecting on behavioral symptom differences, but not on serum parameters. It is not affecting on serum changes of serum parameters within the given dose. When you talk about the other oxidative stress parameters, like oxidative stress, when you talk about the oxidative stress, we can talk about the enzymes. Oxidative stress enzymes are there, like SOD, superoxide dismutase. Whenever that oxidative stress is increased in body, what happens? Immediately, our body self-defense mechanism will produce some of the enzymes which fight against the free radicals. So if oxidative free radicals are more, what happens? It SOD, the superoxide dismutase, increases, and it cleaves the superoxide radicals and makes into H2O. And H2O is more, then immediately it has to be cleaved by your catalase, otherwise oxidative radical increases. In the same way, glutathione peroxidase enzyme also affects on this catalase radicals, OH radicals and catalyzes that. Therefore, we have studied superoxide dismutase, glutathione peroxidase, as well as catalase. These three enzymes we have studied in different time periods, like first hour of injection of domic acid, after 24 hours of the shellfish poisoning, and after 72 hours of the shellfish poisoning, as well as different doses, 3, 4, and 5 mg we have given. So we have seen that initially the S4D is more affected in 3 mg, and finally it is coming down when we have made. That means S4D is decreased when compared to the control. That means the HM is more affecting, that means more problems are there. And when you talk about the lipid peroxidation, so melaldehyde is one of the chemical compound which is considered as a lead role in lipid peroxidations, which is the outer, when a protein is, when a lipid is peroxidized, it leads to MDA. Therefore, we have studied that how much protein carbonyls are formed by giving this in the brain tissue, how much protein carbonyl formed and how much MDA is formed. And we have seen that definitely this domic acid induces melaldehyde, that means lipid is oxidized, peroxidized. At the same time, protein also oxidized and leads to formation of protein carbonyls. That's why we have studied this both, and the toxicity is through the oxidative stress. We have confirmed that depending on the enzymes, oxidative stress enzymes, as well as this lipid and protein oxidation. Then further what we have done, this is amnesic shellfish poison. Amnesic shellfish poison means it definitely affects on brain. That's why what we have done, we have taken the hippocampal area of the animal brain, and we have studied the protein western blotting through that BDNF. This is a brain-derived neurofactor. Normally, when brain-derived neurofactor is more, then the neuronal damage will be less. When it is damaged, that means BDNF expression will be less. So what we have seen here, when we have given more concentration of domic acid, that affects on expression of BDNF, and that if you see the bandwidth of this BDNF is decreasing, the dose dependently decreasing. Initially control is having good, and when you are increasing the concentration of the domic acid, the bandwidth is coming to down, decreasing. Actually, this is a neuroplasticity marker. This is a brain stress marker, also you can call it as a neuronal stress marker, because that is the main control BDNF levels, which is the major symptoms for amnesia. Now, finally, with the toxicity studies, we are coming into the conclusion of the toxicity. It is definitely the domic acid injection is increasing by time dependent. First hour, second, 24 hours and 72 hours, it is increasing. It increases oxidative stress and the behavioral responses also increasing. And it is, and after oxidative stress, this is loss of synaptic plasticity because BDNF is increasing. Due to this, this BDNF triggers the cascades of pathways which is involved in pathophysiology of domic acid toxicity. When you come to the treatment, once the toxicity is more, then how we have to treat this domic acid, shellfish poison? As we know that there would be no shellfish treatment for the shellfish poisoning. They will give only on the basis of symptomatic treatment. If the symptoms are there, for amnesia is there, they will give some paracetamol or some medicines to treat that only. And if seizures are there, they will treat the seizures. But as such, they will not consider, there is no antidote as on date. Therefore, we are now, this study, what we are focusing on, antidotes, that too through herbal antidotes. So what we have done, we have screened several medicinal plants like Terbinafine Arjuna, Pennax Ginseng, Evalus Alsonides, and Ginkgo Biloba. And what we have done, we have first studied the phytochemicals present in this Pennax Ginseng and other Arjuna and Evalus and Ginkgo. Then after we are knowing that this is having highly bioactive compounds, we have extracted that major bioactive extract, measured bioactive compound, and we have given it to the in vitro cell line studies, and we have seen that protective effects. Once we know that which plant is giving major protective effect, which has been further studied on experimental mice. Like what we have done, phytochemicals LCMS studies we have done, and we have studied individual phenols, flavonoids, and antioxidant assays we have studied. And further afterwards, we have gone through in vitro cell line, we have done cell morphology, cytotoxicity, oxidative stress, as well as apoptotic cell death. Then in same way, in vivo cell line in Balbisi mice, we have done behavioral studies, oxidative neuronal stress, histopathology, and apoptotic cell death. When it comes to that cell HPLC studies, these are the standard, first A graph is a standard graph. There we can see that Pimax ginseng, the ginsenocytes like RE, RGO, RBO, and other things. And same thing we have extracted from Pimax ginseng extract. And we have studied on cell line, that is, we have given domoic acid. And that definitely it has provided cell death. But along with the domoic acid, what we have done, we have given Pimax ginseng 100 microgram per ml, and we have given to the cell line, then it is started protecting the cell. That means this Pimax ginseng extract, a saponin rich extract, which is really working against our domoic acid toxicity. Now, what is the pathway which is affecting? Again, we have seen that reactive oxygen species as well as reactive nitrogen species, definitely, which is affecting against the domoic acid induced oxidative stress. And further enzyme studies we have done, superoxide dismutase, catalase, and glutathione peroxidase, and glutathione reductase. All these four enzymes are antioxidant enzymes, and definitely the supplementation of Pimax ginseng is definitely affected and reduced the domoic acid toxicity. Further, we can say that the good preservation, malonaldehyde concentration also reduced by the supplementation of Pimax ginseng extract. And when we talk about the animal studies, then again, what we have done, we have given the domoic acid to the animal, and afterwards, after the injection of domoic acid, we have given our plant extract, and we have seen what is the effect on this. So for that, we have studied animal studies. We have taken the Institutional Animal Ethical Committee approval for the taking, and this we have given the approval number, because wherever we show the animal data, animal experiments, we are ethically supposed to show the approval number. Unless until we have taken approval, we cannot proceed the studies. So afterwards, what we have done, we have taken 30 Balbisi mice and divided into 5 groups. One is control group, second one is domoic acid individual group. Then we have given Pimax ginseng 2 different doses, and one we have given normally available medicine, that is paracetam, which is normally giving for amnesia patients. Same thing we have given to the animal to see the difference between available drug for amnesia and our Pimax ginseng, how it is available. And after the completion of behavioral studies, we have immediately after, we have sacrificed the animal by giving mild anesthetic condition, that is injecting xylazine and ketamine. And when you see the studies, we have given behavioral recognition memory. How to see the memory in the animal? So what we have done in animals, we have given one testing group where we have shown one particular material to the animal, and we have allowed to train that animal to find that object. And after that testing period, we have changed one place. We have given known subject, another one is novel object. Familiar object and novel object, and exploration time we have counted how much exploited time. That means where the novel objective, it is putting more time, that means that much it's having recognition memory. It can recognize that novel object. If it is not been present in any of the object, that means it is not recognizing the memory. That means it's amnesia. It is under amnesia. So this is a exploration time of mice towards a familiar object versus novel object. So what we have found, the domoic acid administration decreases the recognition memory. At the same time, our Pimax ginseng extract supplementation improved the memory. And further, what we have done, another Morris water maze test. This is a small behavioral test for long-term memory. What initially we have done, that is short-term memory, and now this is the long-term memory. There, what we have done, we have made a a small swimming tank. In that one hidden platform we have given, in that hidden platform we show that animal that can, if once that go to the hidden platform, that can stand on that platform and it can breathe easily. If it is not able to find out that platform, it will be dipped down to the any that mice into the water. Therefore, initially we will show that where that platform is there, so that animal has to be recognized immediately and it has to enter. In second, after landing, directly it enters and it will go and sit on the platform. If it is not recognizing, it is not, memory is not good, it will go on searching that platform, where is it. So it will take too much of time to find out that hidden platform in the water. So on that basis, how much time it took to recognize that hidden platform, we will consider how much its memory, long term memory is there. So we have done several trials and we found that domoic acid definitely induced escape latency. That means it reduced its memory in 30 seconds it takes. Others have taken very fast. Therefore, we can say that its memory is increased by providing supplementation of Pinnac ginseng extract. And again, we have seen that oxidative stress, superoxide dismutase, catalase, glutathione peroxidase, and glutathione reductase, everywhere the Pinnac ginseng, both the doses, has been improved the oxidative enzymes. And another one, again, we have done melanodehydrate, which is the lipid peroxidation and protein oxidation. And the balance between the excitatory and inhibitory amino acids in the key factors is neuronal damage. So this is called as a excitotoxicity. So what we are saying here, PG supplementation able to reduce the induced seizures activity in behavior study we have studied. And GABA, which is a main neurotransmitter for this recognition of memory, which has been depleted by DEA supplementation, domoic acid supplementation. When we are given paracetam, which is a known drug, it immediately increased the depleted GABA levels. At the same time, PG 50 or Pinnac ginseng in 50 mg and 500 mg also increased the depleted domoic acid levels. Therefore, we can say this glutamate excitotoxicity has been controlled by supplementation of Pinnac ginseng. And further, what we have seen, this is a glutamate inhibitor, or we can say that this is a binding glutamate receptors. So what are the glutamate kinase receptors present? So GRIK1, GRIK2, GRIK3, GRIK4, and GRIK5. These are the five receptors are present in kinase and glutamate. So what we have done? We have done RT-PCR studies and we find how much the receptors of the expressions have been increased with the Pinnac ginseng supplementation, or else we can say how much domoic acid suppressed the exhibition of this expression of these receptors. So further, what we have done, these kinase receptors like GRK1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 have been, we have seen that initial 1 and 2, 3 have been increased by DEA. That means domoic acid injection, these three receptors expression is increased, but further provided by our Pinnac ginseng, that has come to the normal level. Even though paracetam, which is a amnesia related drug, which is not able to bind or control the receptors expression, but Pinnac ginseng is able to control. This is the major one. And GRK1, that is a kinase receptor, even domoic acid is affecting that receptor. Even GRIK4 and 5 is not being affected by either domoic acid nor our plant extract or paracetam. But only three receptors are being affected. Those are the glutamate receptors or kinase receptors. And MAP kinase we have seen, this is a mitogen activated protein kinases. This is a member of stress kinase pathway, which is the major first one. Once MAP kinase is increased, that means the all relevant pathway genes will be expressed more. In that way, inflammation comes. So neuronal inflammation comes and finally neuronal cell death happens. There's apoplectic cell death and neuroinflammatory cell death happens. So we have seen that neuroinflammation, how it happens. So here MAP kinase is increased by domoic acid and further supplemented of our ginseng extract are reduced. That means this is the MAP kinase pathway, which is directly affected by the domoic acid excitotoxicity toxicity, and which is also our extract shows that it is affecting to reduce the amnesia by this pathway. Then further we have seen, okay, neuroinflammation is pathway is affected, then what are the other really only other linked things like NRF2, that is nuclear factor erythroid 2, this is NFR2. And in the same way, nuclear factor kappa light chain enhancer of activator B cells, which is NFKB. And nitric oxide synthase and COX, this is cyclooxygenase, which are the pro-inflammatory and inflammatory genes. So we have seen this Western blot expression of these proteins, how this has been expressed. The first one is control, second line is domic acid, and third line is paracetam, which is a known drug. And fourth and fifth are phenox ginseng extract, 50 mg per kg body weight and 100 mg per kg body weight we have seen. So if you see GAPDH, which is a housekeeping gene, there all the genes are expressed similarly equally. When you come to the NRF2, the gene expression, Western blot, the protein expression was lesser. That means domic acid is reduced the expression levels of NRF2. When you talk about our provided supplementation of this extract is increased. Same way NFKB, the nuclear factor, and COX and NOS, these three are inflammatory expressions. So this inflammation is increased in domic acid, and further it has been reduced with the supplementation of our extract. When you come back to the Krebs and BDNF, so why we are talking about Krebs and BDNF? Because in this amnesia or neuroplasticity, when neuroplasticity studies, when you talk about, we have to talk about that BDNFT, brain-derived neurofactor. And brain-derived neurofactor will be produced by the CREB, which is a CAMP, CAMP. We can call it as a CAMP response element binding protein is a CREB. So it actually, CREB is a transcription factor for the BDNF. Once CREB is increased, then BDNF increases. If any toxicity, neurotoxicity comes, it first initially when calcium is, what we talk about, this is a calcium influx, excitotoxicity. When intracellular calcium is increased, immediately it stops the Krebs pathway, it affects. So Krebs will not be increases. Because of the Krebs is decreasing, BDNF decreases. But in here, what we are seeing, in the second, number two, where BDNF, there is a completely blank or very less light. We cannot see that, because that means the domic acid is expressed very less. That means it is depleted the BDNF levels. But slowly, it has been increased with the supplementation of our extract, it shows. The same way Krebs also happened. So here we can see that in our Western blots, you may not be able to find out. That's why we have given the relative expression one dendrogram, we have given how much DA and others. So you can see how it has been increased. So further, we can see the apoptotic cell death pathway. When you talk about apoptotic cell death pathway, they are mainly BCL2, that means B cell lymphoma 2, which is actually BCL2 and BAX. BAX is BCL2 associated X protein. When BAX is increasing means cell death happening. When BCL2 increasing means cell is surviving. So these two are opposite. So when you see that BAX is increasing in DA, and the same way, the domic acid supplementation, second one line, DA BAX is increasing. But our extracts that has been decreased, means cell death has been decreased, because this is a pathway genes, BCL2. And which pathway? This is a caspase cascade. This is a cascade, we can say, because caspase is a group of cascades are there. Caspase 3, caspase 6, caspase 9, like this. So one is the first starting is caspase 9, then it is caspase 3, and finally leads to apoptotic cell death. So in this way, we can definitely, confirmly we can say, this is because of apoptotic cell markers as well as neuronal stress by BDNF and the same time excitotoxicity. And finally, now we have confirmed that our extract, whatever our we have given, that genocide rich phenax ginseng extract is affecting the domic acid induced toxicity. It is decreasing that. And further, what we have done, we wanted to see really these whatever genocytes are there, available genocytes, there are 6-7 genocytes are there, genocide A, genocide B, genocide RB, genocide RC, genocide RO. So whether really are they are working, whether they are really blocking the domic acid. For that, what we have done molecular docking study. That means we have done that study, the molecular structures with computer logarithms, and we have done simple docking how these enzymes are molecules ligand with the both. So here we have seen the left side is the domoic acid and right side, for example, is the right side is your protein which is receptor. If how if both are coming like a enzyme and a key enzyme, what we can say, how it is locking. In the same way here, we want to find whether is it able to lock that. If it is able to lock, then that only will be able to become a potential drug. Therefore, we have done that locking studies. Here, these are the receptors GRI, K1, K2, K3, because we have not taken K4 and K5, because none of the domoic acid is affected on these two receptors. So only three receptors is affected. Therefore, we have studied these three receptors with our Pennox ginseng saponins, like genocytes, what we can call. All the genocytes we have studied with this. And we have seen how these are the scores and everything. Here I am showing only the major conclusion of the docking study, because this is a big, it's itself becoming a big presentation. That's why I have only the conclusion of the docking study I have brought here. So here, this is a model we have selected, 4BDM, 4WNC and 4MF. These are linking with the, one of the amino acid and two of the amino acids. And like this, the docking happened. That means clearly it shows that these genocytes are locking the receptors. Through that locking mechanism, it is affecting the receptors blocking, and finally that is able to reduce the excitotoxicity. Therefore, I made a final conclusion, a diagram, how our saponin rich extract, that is genocytes, are affecting this domoic acid toxicity through calcium overload, how it is receptors it is blocking. Therefore, calcium overload is stopping. Therefore, GABA levels, normally DA is, domoic acid is increasing, but our supplementation of Pennax ginseng extract is stopping that GABA level depletion. Same way that the signals like MAPK, ERK, GNK pathways, it is stopping. Then activation of neural factors and transcription or inflammatory factors like COX and iNOS and interleukins and tumor necrosis factors, it is stopping. Therefore, it is stopping through oxidative stress mechanism like lipid peroxidation, protein carbonyls, as well as antioxidant mechanism enzymes, S4D catalase, GPX. Therefore, finally, it is stopping the neurodegeneration and whatever the domoic acid induced neurotoxicity, shellfish poisoning is being reduced by supplementation of Pennax ginseng saponin rich extract. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you
so much for so much valuable guidance. Every coin has a two sides. It is correctly said. Whenever we look at the sea, we have a wonderful feeling. Even the great philosopher, the Christopher Columbus, has correctly said that the sea will grant each man a new hope. Sea, oceans are so much important for us. But when we look at the second side of the coin, there are so many toxins, there are so many adverse things which are present in the oceans. Entire things which were included into your presentation, like harmful algal blooms, freshwater toxins, including hepatotoxins, neurotoxins, even the cylindrospermopsin, the various examples of algal shellfish toxins, domoic acid, and their oxidative stress, its effect on lipid metabolism and neuronal plasticity. Really, the depth of the research and the biochemical and biophysical techniques which you are using and handling in your lab are really commendable, sir. Being a session chair,
sir, Dabade.
Yes, ma'am. Being a session chair, I now request Dr. Aryas Badhare, sir, to express his expert remark for this session. Sir. Badere sir, are you there?
And your test professor in
Hello, Badere sir, are you there? Sir, there is a question in the chat box, if you can see. If you want, I can read that for you. Okay, this is from, he has not mentioned his name, but how you made sure that animals which were sacrificed using anesthesia, the use of anesthesia is not making any difference on the later results? So could you please answer this question, sir?
Anesthesia, mild anesthesia, we will give, that's why.
Achha. Okay, fine. Sir, Badhare, sir, are you there?
Am I audible?
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir, you are.
Audible?
Sir, go on. You are audible.
Okay, fine. So, good morning, everyone. So, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers and especially my friend, Dr. Deepak Koche, for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to chair this session. And the coincidence is that the person who is speaking is again one of my good friends. And we know each other from last 20 years. And I have seen him as a in his doctoral research as an MSc student. And really, I have a witness for his progress. And today I can see his COVID-19 look with, I think the beard is here. So nice to see you, Fani Kumar.
Thank you.
I can take the liberty to call him by his name.
Definitely, sir.
Thank you. It was nice to listen to your second talk. The first talk I have addressed was in 2013.
And Dr. Alka Chaturvedi, madam's retirement function.
Yeah. That's correct. And now, in this topic, you have detailed about the toxins, very nicely explained. He has started. It must have been very helpful for the students who are in their learning phase to know the toxins of algae and its effect, not only on the biota of the water body, but also the human beings. And in what way it affects the human beings to the level that it may also lead to the death of the person. Now, I hope there is no other question from the audience. I congratulate.
Not yet, sir.
Okay, that's fine. I congratulate Dr. Fani Kumar.
Thank you.
For you successfully completing your work. And you have nicely explained right from the scratch, right from the basics to the how it can be applied. You have touched upon the phytochemistry, you have touched upon the physiology, molecular biology also, and ended up with the gel docking, right? You have tested, you have started with four plants, I think.
Yes.
Arjuna, Panax, Evolvulus, and Jingo.
Yes.
Right. Evolvulus, I think it is Shankh Pushpi. Okay. And good results, best results you have got is about Panax.
Yes.
And probably it is because of saponins.
Saponin, we have extracted saponin-rich ginseng.
Okay. So can you tell which extract was it?
Genocide-rich extract.
No. It means what was the solvent?
This actually you get available ginseng.
It is available.
In the market. Saponin, the 40% saponin-rich extract.
Okay. Achha, just a query. Can we explore any other plants which are rich source of saponins?
Definitely. Bacopa is there.
Okay.
Bacocides are a part of terpenoid saponins.
Okay.
That could be able, we have done on Bacopa also. Okay. That is affecting in amnesia as well as memory enhancement and anti-fatigue also.
Okay. But is it possible that it may be useful against domoic acid also, against as an antidote of, to domoic acid?
Actually, here that that's why what we have seen, even normally paracetamol drug is there, which is being used for amnesia.
Uh-huh.
We have studied. It is affecting on amnesia only.
Okay.
But actually, this domoic acid is affecting on the receptors, that is kinase receptors. So
right.
that particular chemical compound able to target that receptors, then only it's effective. So what we have seen that GLUK 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, out of 5, this domoic acid is affecting only 3 receptors. Remaining 2, it is not at all binding. So this 3 receptors only, expression is decreasing by domoic acid injection. Therefore, we have seen whether that whatever depleted receptor expression is increased or not. That is a major our finding is that.
Okay.
So we have to one has to study whether whatever extract or whatever compound we are taken, whether really it is able to reach the receptors.
Okay. Very. Okay. Fine. Best luck.
Thank you.
So off from me.
Thank you.
Okay.
And I'm thankful to Dr. Deepak Kochi, who has given me opportunity, and organizing secretaries and organizing committee members. I'm very thankful to them to given me this opportunity.
Indeed, sir. We are also happy that all the three best friends, Dr. Kochi sir, Badere sir, and Pani Kumar sir, we brought you three together on the same platform. And we were like, go on listening your scientific talk.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you
for your efforts in this COVID situation also.
Okay. We now go to the second plenary session.
Sir.
It's a great pleasure. Okay. I now call my friend Sachin Gupekar, sir, assistant professor in the Department of Biochemistry, Shivaji College of Arts, Commerce and Science, to express his warm thanks for this wonderful lecture. Over to you, Sachin. Mute.
Thank you, sir, to allowing me this opportunity. I am Sachin S. Gupekar, assistant professor in Department of Biochemistry of Sri Shivaji College of Arts, Commerce and Science, Akola. First of all, I would like to thanks to Dr. G. Fani Kumar, sir, senior scientist at Nutritional and Biochemistry, Biochemical, Nutritional Biochemical and Toxicology Laboratory, DRDO, Mysore, for delivering his very important, informative, innovative, and incredible lecture in the morning session of the third days of International E-Conference on Innovative Research Trend in Life Sciences, which is organized by Department of Life Sciences of Sri Shivaji College of Arts, Commerce, and Science, Akola, with the collaboration with Indian Science Congress Association, Amravati Chapter. Sir, you have volubly put your vote on algal shell fish poisoning,
like,
development and evolution of herbal antidotes. In this lecture, you covered some very important aspects of algal blooms and their roles, beneficial aspects, beneficial and detrimental aspects of algae, freshwater and marine water toxins, marine food web. You also told about the algal shellfish toxin with their chemical structure and harmful effect. Amnesic shellfish poisoning, mice model of domoic acid induction, effect of domoic acid on a neuronal plasticity, and herbal antidote of herbal antidote studies, and many more for you point you have to covered in your excellent lecture. Thank you again sir for your very nice lecture. I would like to thanks again to the our chairperson, Mr. Professor R.S. Badere sir, Department of Botany in Sant Rashtra Sant Tukdoji Maharaj Nagpur University, Nagpur, for his great and grand guidance. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I would like to thanks again for Simit Rokde, sir, for introducing our speaker, and also thanks to the Mr. Ravi Dabade, sir, for his shine and fine anchoring. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Am I audible? It is our great pleasure to have most distinguished and renowned personality for our second guest lecture for today's session. Dr. Anshuman Sarkar is working as an associate professor in the Department of Biological Science, Birla Institute of Technology and Science, Pilani, shortly abbreviated as BITS Pilani, Birla Campus, Goa. Sir will be talking upon the quinacrine induces ROS-mediated activation of stress and apoptotic pathway in human non-small cell lung cancer cell lines cultured in vitro. Also, we are very pleased to have the most esteemed head department of zoology, Sri Ramji Moghi College, Pandarkavda, Dr. R.S. Virani, as a session chair. Sir, are you there? Virani, sir? I now request Dr. P.M. Makude, sir, assistant professor and head department of zoology, Dr. R.G. Rathod College, Murtizapur, who introduced our guest speaker.
Thanks, madam.
Makode, sir.
Yes. Am I audible, madam?
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. Thanks, madam. A warm noon and welcome to all the participants today on third day of international e-conference. I am here for introduction of chairperson and resource person of today's session. We have Dr. Ranjan Virani, chairperson of this session. I heartily welcome Dr. Virani, sir, on behalf of organizing committee. Dr. Ranjan Virani, sir, is associate professor and head department of zoology, Sri Ramji Moghi Science College, Pandarkavda, district Yavatmal. Sir is working as an ecologist and expert in man-animal conflict management. Sir contribute to the conservation of as an ecologist and declaring ESZ around Tipeshwar wildlife sampling. Sir is working as a ESZ monitoring committee as a team member. Sir work as biologist to establish critical wildlife habitat in Tipeshwar WLS. Sir is working as a LEC member for Tiger Tourism Project. Virani sir is working as a wildlife expert in Tiger Target Cell. I welcome Dr. Virani sir as a chairperson for this session. Let I introduce today's resource person. Today's resource person, Dr. Anshuman Sarkar sir, as a resource person for this plenary talk of this session. Sir is associate professor, Department of Biological Science, Birla Institute of Technology and Science, BITS Pilani, Goa. Sir, research subject is biotechnology. These are some career highlights of Sarkar, sir. Sir published 27 research papers in international journal. Out of these, one paper is in number one oncology journal in the world, 2020. Sir selected as a fellow from All India Society of Cell Biology in 2016. He's awarded Young Investigator for Pilot Project Grant by DBT Cancer Biology Mission in 2015. He is awarded Appreciation Certificate by Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center USA in 2008 for outstanding leadership
and commitment in the cancer research in 2009. Sir awarded as a research associateship by Department of Cell and Molecular Biology, Cleveland, USA in 2007. Sir offered University, New York, USA for the postdoctoral training in 2004. He awarded CSIR SRF by Government of India, New Delhi in 2002. With these highlights, I request sir to please share his view and we are eagerly waiting for his plenary talk. Sarkar sir, please.
Am I audible to everybody?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You are.
Okay, thank you. So, good afternoon, everybody. This is my pleasure to talk in the International E-Conference on Innovative Research Trends in Life Sciences, organized by Department of Life Sciences, Sri Shivaji Science College, Arts, Commerce and Science, Akola, in collaboration with Indian Science Congress Association, Amravati Chapter. First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee, as well as Dr. R. M. Pise, the principal and chief organizer, Dr. P. P. Umale, professor and head botany department and convener, as well as Dr. D. K. Koche, who is a professor in botany, as well as the organizing secretary of this conference. Thank you very much for the brief introduction, and I would like to share my screen now. Is it visible now with everybody?
Yes, sir, it is.
Okay. So I am going to talk about a small molecule known as quinacrine, which induces reactive oxygen species mediated activation of stress and in apoptotic pathway in human non-small cell lung cancer cell lines cultured in vitro. Instead of saying so much hodgepodge, if I say simply that it acts, this particular molecule acts on human lung cancer, I think that is much more easier. And this molecule has gotten very important. Yeah? Any question? Hello? Is it fine? Or?
No, sir. Yeah, it's okay. That may be a noise.
Okay. Go on, sir. Okay. So, and in the background of the BITS Pilani KK Birla Goa campus, that's our main building where presently I am working. So, cancer is one of the most common disease in the developed world. Not only in developed world, as well as in the developing world. One in four deaths are due to any kind of cancer. And one of 17 deaths are due to lung cancer. Lung cancer is the most common cancer in men, whereas breast cancer is the most common cancer in women where people diagnosed and die. There are over 100 different forms of cancer. This is a very deadly disease, and the death rate in the coming time, if we do not consider the cardiac events, I mean death due to cardiac problem, cancer is one of the highest among all in various parts of the world. So why a person gets cancer? Definitely there are thousands of papers are available over the PubMed and published. And these are some of the common features and common cause of cancers, all we know. And the substance that cause cancer is, we call it as a carcinogen. And the process of cancer development is known as carcinogenesis. Smoking and environmental agents can cause cancer, very well known, these two. And then mutation in various oncogene that can cause cancer. Age-related aging is a process where you can see the cancer, and definitely obesity is another cause of cancer. So in Indian story of cancer triggers can be, but one thing is definitely there, that cancer is curable if it detected at early age. But the problem here in the world is, who will detect that at what early stage? Early stage means I talk it about one, stage one, stage 2A, at least stage 2B. So it is fully curable cancers. And cancer is preventable. Means cancer could be prevented at an extent. Cancer affects 10 lakh in India every year, and it kills 7 lakh. 40% cancers linked to tobacco in India. And incidence of cancer is 90 per 1 lakh in cities and 45 in rural India. In the West, the incidence is 350. Colon cancer affects 5 among 1 lakh Indians. In the West, 60 to 70 get affected by colon cancer. And why the lung cancer, and why Sanjay Dutt? So we all know he has been suffering with, initially it was said that he is hospitalized, but then we all came to know that he has been suffering with lung cancer. And the lung cancer, why it caused? Mostly because of smoking. It can be active smoking as well as passive smoking. If somebody has a lung disease like COPD, if one is exposed to chemical and random exposures, as well as air pollution. In India, Delhi and Delhi urban region is the worst affected scenario of pollution, and there the cause of lung cancer has been increasing day by day. The same way, after 9/11 in New York City, the people who had the lung cancer, it has directly increased suddenly, like couple of fold. And the cause they have given, because the disaster of the Twin Tower and the kind of asbestos smokes came out from the tower, that caused a lot of lung cancer incident. So what is non-small cell lung cancer? These are accounts for approximately 80% of all lung cancer cases worldwide, and is highly invasive or metastatic. That means if it detects, it can immediately, it can spread in the body within few months. There was an incident that patient had reported a cerebral attack, and then when the doctor was seeing that patient, they find out there are some blood clots, not only in her brain, as well as in the lung as well. So they tried to find out the reason. Then they saw some patches in the lung. Then later on, they find out it's because of lung cancer, the brain hemorrhage happened. And that's what exactly happened with this lung, small cell lung cancer. They metastasize directly in the brain. That's what it is, very, very dangerous. High metastatic potential, and it is highly invasiveness. That means it can invade the tissue very rapidly. And we are still far behind effectively understanding the mechanism and being able to control it through the therapeutic means. Another issue with this small cell lung cancer is its chemo resistance. That is the is another aspect which frequently associated with non-small cell lung cancer. It's poor survival outcome. Clinical studies done so far present a worrying aspect of chemotherapeutic treatment for NSCLC. Almost all patients who receive treatment of NSCLC develop resistance after few cycles of chemotherapy. That is why chemotherapy doesn't successful, and in most of the cases, the patient die. Many major breakthroughs have been made in last two decades for treating non-small cell lung cancer cells, an invention of specific kinase inhibitors such as dasatinib, which is a very popular drug for lung cancer patients, and discovery of a new aspect of therapy called immunotherapy for cancer treatment is coming up. And there are some inhibitor like VEGF receptors, Herceptin or HER receptors, etc., have been newly incorporated for management of cancer. These innovative therapeutic strategies have improved the patient survival by a great deal. Still, nearly three quarters of patients do not survive past 5 years diagnosis period. This is very, very important. So that is the background of our research. I have been involved in this research since past almost 10 years. I am a cell and molecular biologist basically, but this is my passion and this is my work. I have been involved with this molecule, particularly quinacrine, when I was in the US. I had started working with this molecule. Then there I had worked with the colon cancer and we produced a drug and it is presently being utilized all over the world. So what is quinacrine? Quinacrine is a synthetic acridine-based drug belonging to 9 aminoacridine family, which was developed in late 1920s, primarily for treatment of malaria. This is very interesting. So in India, we are not naive to this particular molecule. If you remember, we had a malaria issue long back in India, and people have been suffering with malaria many places. And doctors started prescribing them quinacrine, okay? Or we used to call it quinine mixture. So quinacrine is part of that mixture. Quinacrine is known to initiate, but most interestingly, quinacrine is known to initiate multiple cellular stress and apoptotic pathways, and many of which are unknown or yet to be understood in details. Despite the study has been carried out, where people have shown that quinacrine is involved in NF-kappa-B activation. NF-kappa-B is a transcription factor, which is directly activates the P53 signaling cascade. And P53, if is activated, it leads to apoptosis or cell death. And that's where the cancer can be managed. So what we did, we have taken two different human cell line. One is human A549, as well as there is H520. These two are the different cell line, human lung cell line. And A549 and H520, we have exposed to different concentration of quinacrine. You can see this is a FACS analysis. FACS is a fluorescence associated cell sorter. So what we did, we took the cells, we stained it with a stain called as propadium iodide, which particularly stained the nucleus. Then we see what happened to the nucleus. And if a nucleus is dead, that show me how many cells are dead and which is going through at what phase of cell cycle. So that's that. The earlier slides, the earlier slides which I showed you, that was FACS analysis where we have shown that how quinacrine affects, and we have shown that quinacrine effect in a concentration dependent manner, time and concentration. This is the cell morphology analysis. We have this is 24 hours as well as 48 hours analysis. So if you particularly see, this panel is cells are stained with phalloidine, which stains the cell's cytoskeleton. And then if you see this, the medium panel is written as Hoechst 3342. That's a nuclear stain. The cell can be stained, the nuclear stain can be seen visible. And you can literally, you can count how many less cells, if we increase the concentration of quinacrine, how it is affecting the cells. The cell number is not only reducing, but at the same time, cells are changing their shape. You can see this is a cell is changing its shape, which is very, very interesting, because the if a cell needs to travel from one place to another, it needs to change its shape and it needs to squeeze itself among the other cell milieu, and it needs to enter into the blood vessels. So that is known as EMT or epithelial to mesenchymal transition. And as I had shown you, the cells were changing its shape. So there are a couple of genes which are responsible for cell shape changes. We also call these as a small GTPases. These are the small G protein which help cells to change its morphology. So RAC, RHO, CDC42, these are the very common small GTPases which helps the cell cytoskeleton modulation, thereby cells change its shape. So how those genes are getting affected with the increasing dose of quinacrine with the time, we have shown that. And this is 18S rRNA, that is the internal control. That means it is, even if it is constant, but still the concentration of these genes or expression pattern of these genes, they are getting changed. Same way, that was at the RNA level, and this is at the protein level, how it happens. So it is not only at the transcription level, but also at the translational level. So what we understood from those experiments, it is quinacrine has a direct dose-dependent effect on the organization of actin cytoskeleton of these cancer cells. Both A549 and H520 cells exhibit formation of the multiple laminipodial extension and stress fiber generation and few membrane ruffles upon exposure to lower concentrations. Whereas at higher concentration exposure, lead the cells to acquire spheroid morphology with numerous microspikes and filopodial extension, which are typically morphology of stressed cells undergoing death process. We have also shown that low family small GTPases, particularly the RAC, RHO, and CDC42 downregulate. And this effect directly collaborated with quinacrine effect on the regulation of small GTPases. This is where we are now directly showing what happened to the cellular nucleus on those cancer cells if we expose them to the higher concentration of quinacrine. This is A549, the top panel. Down panel is H520. So you can see there is a difference. This is at 48 hours, 24 hours. You can see how nucleus is, a cell number is getting reduced. Not only that, you can see the breakage of the nucleus membrane. So that shows clearly the apoptosis is onset. The apoptosis is in the place. This is again the flow cytometry analysis after staining the propidium iodide, where we have shown that how cell death has been occurring, as well as cells are which phase of the cell cycle during the whole death process. And which are the cell cycle proteins are involved? We have shown it by RT-PCR, that means at RNA level as well as at protein level, cyclin D1, cyclin B1, in both 24 as well as 48 hours. These are all comparable, and they are all if you compare with their nuclear breakage, these all cell cycle protein are actually helping us to understand why the cell cycle and which part of the cell cycle is getting affected by the exposure of quinacrine, for how many what is the concentration, as well as at what time point. This is a typical cyclin B1 protein, which is important one to understand, as when if we say that these cells are not growing and we have stopped the metastasis, that means the growth and division of the cancer cells, then we need to show that at which time point of the cell cycle the cell stop growing or they are dying. So that particular time point we have captured. So basically what we say from this result is quinacrine inhibits cell cycle progression as well as by arresting the cells at G1S checkpoint through increasing fragmentation of the DNA population in human A549 cells and terminally arresting cells at G01 stage. It also downregulates the expression of cyclin D1 and B1 at both transcriptional as well as translational level, along with approximately two-fold decline in PCNA protein, which is a DNA polymerase-associated protein. That means DNA expression or DNA polymerization is not happening. This effect cumulatively leads to shutdown the cell cycle machinery. This is another experiment to show that this is a JC1 dye we have used that shows the how it is mitochondria is getting affected. Because if you go to the classical biology experiments of apoptosis, that means program of cell death, it happens in two ways. One is extracellular and another is intracellular. And intracellular way, where the mitochondria is involved, mitochondria get ruptured and then the cytochrome C get released. Cytochrome C binds with apoph1 and they form an apoptosome. Then it follows the cascade pathway for apoptosis. So you have shown that mitochondria is also getting damaged with this JC1 dye. It takes a snapshot of that particular moment, and much more is the damage to mitochondria, much more JC1 dye is leaked out. That's what we have shown now. Apoph1, you can see, just before this, I have told you what is apoph1. And superoxide dismutases are also getting involved. HSP70, another stress protein which is involved. So all these parameters are getting tweaked by the quinacrine, which helps the cells to go through the apoptosis. I am not going into details of this pathway. This is, we have done some, which pathway it is getting involved actually. We have done the detailed molecular mechanism. Then actually this mechanism helps us to understand the molecular biology and the mechanism behind how this quinacrine is at which pathway is affecting the cells. This is some docking experiment we have done, which I am not going to talk right now. I'll just skip. So you can just come here that quinacrine is directly responsible for generation of intracellular ROS, activating the genes and proteins of the oxidative and endoplasmic reticulum stress and pathway, which drives the cell into apoptotic phase. And elevated ROS caused pronounced damage to the outer membrane of the mitochondria, leading to formation of transition, which is released to cytochrome C into cytoplasm and accelerate the apoptosome formation. Now it comes to from the cell line, we have gone into the tumor directly. We have induced tumor in mice, that's the control tumor, and we have exposed to different concentration of quinacrine just to see what happens actually. Is it really true if this drug is working or not? And we have shown it, wow, we have got something which is at least reduced the tumor size drastically. we have produced xenograft mice, skid mice, and we have injected a quinacrine, and you can see how the quinacrine is affecting the tumor. This is another way to show in vitro level of matrigel-based migration assay of the cells. So if it, whether it also arrests the metastasis, that means growth of the cancer cells to reach towards the other organ. So can it stop those cancer cells to reach to the other organ? Our results says clearly that it can. That's what we have done in lab. We call it, it's called as a matrigel-based cell migration invasion assay using a different concentration of quinacrine. And as well as those tumors what we have got, we have done the extensive study of those tumor. And then what we have shown here, the quinacrine also inhibits cell migration process through downregulation of EMT marker such as vimentin, n-cadherin, and MMP9 in both in vitro as well as in vivo models. So these are nothing but HNE staining or multiple foci of degenerative changes of tumor cells and reduction in tumor mass as noted by loss of cellular tissue and presence of liquefactive changes in quinacrine-treated tumor tissue section as compared to a well-known tumor mass that presence of proliferating neoplastic cells throughout the tissue in the control group. Okay, so here what happens, what we see in the quinacrine in control, expression of vimentin receptors in the tumor tissue mass, observation of five different sites in the average, we have given these as a, how it is, in the, quinacrine is affecting. But another very interesting observation, what we find in the low dose and the high dose grade, it's if we expose it to a high dose for a short time, it affects much more. And again, this is the molecular biology to show really what we are saying is right or not. So you require to prove. In science, every time you need to prove. You need to prove yourself. You need to prove your results every time by different experiments. And that's what we always do in the lab. We always ask a question and then we try to see what is its, we try to seek its answer. And here we have shown that vimentin expression, n-cadherin expression, MMP9 expression, e-cadherin expression, as well as internal control, 18S RNA. So finally, what we conclude is NSCLC cells with mutated tumor suppressor genes responds differently to drugs and are known to be restrained and aggressive. Quinacrine has shown a very promising potential through acting as a modulator of actin cytoskeleton organization and assembly through regulation of RhoGTPases, RAC, RhoA, and CDC42. Direct effect on the synthesis of cell cycle driving protein is a new interesting feature of quinacrine, which can be significantly studied. And it is very significant in proliferation and control of cancer cells. Induction of ROS and mitochondria mediated apoptosis is a whole new aspect of quinacrine's mechanisms of action. GSD1 inhibition is a new novel finding which expands the role of quinacrine in overcoming the chemo resistance and reducing cell survival. Overall, new mechanisms and potential enzymes target explored will add knowledge and value to the anti-cancerous potential of quinacrine, which could help in curbing the growth and spread of cancer and reducing its lethality. So this is the, in a nutshell, what we have found out. We have found out a quinacrine, a small molecule which enters inside the cell. It goes directly and enter in the nucleus and it arrests the cell cycle, lead to apoptosis. At the same time, it affects the cell cytoskeleton through RAC, Rho, and CDC42 proteins, small GTPs. It involved in HSP70, and it acts the phospho-EIF2-alpha, it expression of alpha EIF2-alpha, which inhibit the protein synthesis, can lead to apoptosis. As well as it binds with GST-alpha and lin kinase. Lin is known for proliferation cell lines. So if it binds with the lin, it will inhibit the cell proliferation. As well as the moment it binds with the GST alpha, It induces ROS, which directly induces the cytochrome C release from the mitochondria and act with the APOF1, which leads to apoptosis. So these are the these four people are actively involved in this research. So this is Mr. Makan Kumar, then this is Angela Samantha. These two are the main person who lead his work. And this story was actually published in the OncoTarget, which is the world best journal in oncology, and subsequently picked up by Times of India. They made a headline story, Indian Express, and then some of the local newspaper, as well as recently BBC has come up with one news on this particular thing. And I received generous funding from DBT, Goa Cancer Society, ICMR, Government of India, and there my sister, Dr. Jyotika Rajivare, he's from Agarkar Research Institute, Pune. We do the animal experiments in ARI Pune. And that's all my. So thank you very much for giving me an opportunity. It was nice to share with you people my talk. Thank you.
Hello.
Yeah.
Dabade sir. Dr. Dabade. Hello.
Hello.
Haan sir. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for such an informative lecture. I wish our MSc students would have joined your session. You have exposed us to various concepts of cell biology, which we have never been exposed to. Thank you so much. Being a session chair, I now request respected Dr. R.S. Virani, sir, head department of zoology, Shivramji Moghe College, Pandarkavada, to express his chairman remark for this session. Virani, sir, are you there? Virani, sir?
Virani, yes, sir. Virani, sir, is there. Wait for a minute.
Okay.
Dr. Virani, sir, you can continue. Are you audible, sir? Virani, sir?
Sir, please unmute yourself. I can see your screen is muted. I mean, your mic is muted. Unmute yourself. Virani, sir? Yes, sir, now you are... Hello?
Yes, sir, he is connecting his audio now.
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, I think there is some problem in his connection. He again get muted.
गूगल पे सर्च करूंगा।
हेलो
हेलो डॉक्टर अर्चना शर्मा, गुड मॉर्निंग। गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
हेलो हेलो, I it's a excellent talk. I just have a question for Dr. Anshuman.
Yes, ma'am.
Can I ask?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, please. You can. Yeah. Go ahead.
It was an excellent talk, doctor. I just wanted to know, like this quinacrine, since it's already like used as a like anti-malarial drug. So, like how do you think that it like as a for clinical trials and all, how easy it would be to like now start those kind of things?
Yeah, it is basically it is very easy because we already have the data, and if you repurpose some of the molecule, that is easier to get an DCGI approval and all the stuff. So we have already, with the Goa Cancer Society, we have already started working in Goa Cancer Hospital, and it is in the clinical stage. And we are doing with some other drug. We are trying to see how it affects and all the stuff.
It was a very informative talk. It's excellent.
Thank you.
Hello, is Virani sir is there? Are you there, sir? Virani sir,
I can see his screen, but his voice is not audible.
Yes, there is some problem in connection of his audio, I think. Now he is connected. Again muted. Okay,
yeah.
we can move on to the vote of thanks.
Ma'am, may I start? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you can start vote of thanks.
Okay, thank you. A very good afternoon to one and all. I am Dr. Archana Savarkar, Associate Professor, Department of Zoology, Sri RLT College of Science, Akola. I take an opportunity to propose vote of thanks of this session number 9 in this international e-conference, Innovative Research Trends in Life Sciences, which is organized by Sri Shivaji College of Arts, Commerce and Science, Akola, in collaboration with Indian Science Congress Association, Amravati chapter. From last 2 days, that is from 3rd December, we have enjoyed feast of knowledge with a galaxy of eminent personnels as resource persons. I express a deep sense of gratitude to the most distinguished speaker of the session, Dr. Anshuman Sarkar sir, Associate Professor, Department of Biological Sciences, BITS Pilani, Goa, for making an excellent presentation and giving a lot of information on topic quinacrine induces ROS-mediated activation of stress and apoptotic pathway in human non-small cell lung cancer cell lines cultured in vitro. Thank you very much, sir, for making the session very interesting, informative, and explaining the topic so nicely by sharing your crucial work with us. Sir, please accept our thanks for a great presentation. I am thankful to Dr. R.S. Virani, sir, Head Department of Zoology, Shivaramji Moghe College, Pandarkauda, for chairing the session. Special thanks goes to Dr. P. M. Makode sir, Assistant Professor and Head, Department of Zoology, Dr. R. G. Rathod College, Murtijapur. I am equally grateful to respected principal Dr. R. M. Bise sir, convener of the conference, Dr. Pratiksha Kokate ma'am, and organizing secretary, Dr. Koche sir, and their complete team for successful organization and conduction of this 3 days international conference. I would like to appreciate and thank all participants for their active and sincere participation. Also, thanks to one and all who have directly and indirectly contributed in making the session a very great success and enriched the event. Thank you very much. Over to Dabade sir for further conduction of program.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for your kind words. We are now in the third lecture of today's session.